Fusion, I think, and I've done like various different really small tiny things here and there. So I didn't really know the franchise or the story or any of the characters in the past, because it was, you know, obviously I was older when it came out. And so when I got the audition, it was for all the characters. So all the characters were in the audition that I received in the email. And I didn't know that they were these were characters from another series, you know, continuing. And so I just auditioned for all the characters, and TK was the one that I was cast as. And then later, I found out, I think, I got an email, I think that was like to a few actors and said, do not talk about working on Digimon, like, you know, because we can't say anything about anything. And I never did. Because of that reason, somebody did and got in trouble, basically. And so I got this email, and then I found out, and then I started to look it up, like, what was it all about? And it was because other characters had saying that other people were saying that they're coming back as a character. And I was like, wait a second, what? And that's how I found out that these were roles that other people had, and I took somebody else's part, you know, and I didn't know. And I was like, holy cow. And then, so then I had to do some research. And I mean, I did figure it out, you know, a little earlier, but I didn't really think much of it. But yeah, then I realized that there were people coming to play their roles again, and so I had to go in and look at all the voices that were TK before. He was much younger then, and he didn't really have that much story to his character, so there wasn't a whole lot that I really needed to focus on. It wasn't like a crazy lisp or a certain way of talking. So I really still had freedom, and he was older. So I really got to just kind of focus on the story and fit into that, you know, mode. And then it was a little scary though, finding out that, you know, I'm the new guy. You know, I'm the new guy. So it's a little more stressful that way. But it was a great series. TK is a great character to play. It was fun. Confessions was an awesome, you know, series or episode for me. Oh, you did? Oh, thanks. Thanks. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. Yes?
So, I know you had passed away an hour ago. Kind of painful doing it, but my question is, one of the other guests you have built into those longer pirates, and so I'm wondering if you potentially would audition for Fire Emblem in the future or with other Nintendo.
I actually had auditioned for a few, couple times. Well, not game, actually, what's it called? What's the series you're talking about?
Fire.
No, is it Fire Emblem? Oh, sorry, no, I did not audition for that. Sorry, I get confused whenever, because it makes me think of, I can't even think of it right now. No. I don't even know the name of it, but it had fire in it. So no, that I did not audition for. But, you know, it's usually auditions, either, you know, most of them come from my agent, but occasionally producers or whoever will send auditions to me. I thought you were talking about something else. Yes? Most awkward, most difficult? That would be for a game that I don't know the name of. I posted a video talking about this, actually. It's Goblin number 13. So I basically got a phone call to come in and to see if I was available the next day to work on a video game. And I was. And I was like, all right, cool. And so I go in, and then director, producer said, hey, this sides are over there for you to go look at your character. And you're playing Goblin number 13. So I go over there and I start flipping through and I'm looking at the character of Goblin number 13, Miscellaneous, and it's just all vowels. It's like O's, O-E-E-I-I-A. I'm like, what is this? I'm like, is it a typo? I'm like, it's all like vowels, what is this? And he's like, oh, so he's like, you know, goblin noises. I start to panic because I have never done any kind of like animal or monster noises. You know, I'm usually just my regular voice, like a young kid voice or something. You never did any kind of character or anything. And so I'm starting to freak out. I'm like, I don't know any goblins. What do goblins sound like? Like, you know, like growling and, you know, fighting monster goblin noises. I'm like, what? And then for whatever reason, I thought back when I was a kid, I had this guinea pig that I would talk to. Now I go, you know, and so I looked at him, I went, like, yeah, do that. And so, for 4 hours, I was just, you know, charging and falling off cliffs and being electrocuted or whatever in this, you know, voice. And so after 4 hours of screaming, I couldn't talk. And so I was like, thanks for the session. The next day, I had like this series I was supposed to work on and did like a young kid voice, but I couldn't do it because I had no voice, and I got recast for an entire series. So I lost a decent job because of this game that I don't know the name of because it was like super secret. A lot of times those things are secret, the games, and so they'll only say like Namco game or whatever, you know, and so I don't know the name of the game. So that would have been the most difficult, I guess, for me. But if you guys are out playing a game and you hear, that's me.
What would you say your dream role?
Dream role? I don't know. Dream role. One that does not end. One that has a really cool story and great characters. That everybody loves. maybe an original story, you know, would be kind of cool. It's always fun to play characters that have more emotional baggage or places to go than just being some kid that controls a mech or something, you know. Not that those can't be good, but there's just so many of them. Yeah. Yes, in the back.
What are some of your personal favorite anime?
Personal favorite anime? Yeah. Just not that I've been in?
Well, in general.
In general. Yeah, that's a good question. Let's see, Akira is definitely one of the first ones for me. I think that was the first one. No, that was one of the first ones that I knew sort of the name anime. That's where I kind of heard it. I think I saw it in a magazine or something. Japanime is what they called it, I think. Or Japanimation, right? Yeah. It was so racist back then. What else? Vampire Hunter D, Bloodlust. Jinro. Yeah, these are older. You guys are like, what? Let's see. Gosh, it's been a long time since I'm from the time. Do you guys remember? Any of you guys remember Blockbuster? Yeah. I don't know if you guys had Suncoast out here, but like you had to go hunt down your DVDs. Well, they didn't have DVDs. You had to go hunt down your VHSs and the volumes. Yeah. Do you really have a Blockbuster? It just closed. It's like the last surviving Blockbuster.
There's
another one? Is it out here too? Oregon? What? Oh wow. Blockbuster. Power Rangers, Blue Ranger, whatever, And so a lot of those guys are now doing other projects, and they've kind of moved on, and they're doing a lot of stunt choreography or bigger things. They're working on everything, really. Transformers, all that stuff. And so occasionally, some of the guys will give me a call and say, hey, usually if it's a person that's going to be doing some kind of action and that has dialogue, you know, so if it's like, because they don't usually throw a stuntman, like they don't want to throw a stuntman into an acting part, you know, they want to be able to throw someone who can act and do stunts in that kind of a role. And so a friend of mine referred me to, both friends of mine, but they were looking for someone because there's some talking in that. That's all it was. And so it was really just kind of me just going like, sure, I'll do it. So, you know, and I knew the people I was there with is just really just a bunch of people that I knew, you know, stunt guys and stuff that I, you know from so many years. But occasionally you might see me, and I was in True Blood as well. occasionally I'm like in there somewhere. Usually if the stunt guy has to say some dialogue and then get beat up or something. But it's always fun, you know, I kind of stick my head out there. But most people don't see it, and I don't really post too much about it or announce it or anything, because it's, you know, it's whatever. But it's funny, though, sometimes, like, I studied jiu-jitsu, and I walk in, and then, like, half the people in there are like, hey, we saw you on the show last night. It's like, yes?
How mad were you about Beach Gaming having worked on it for so many years?
I'm sorry, what was that?
How mad were you about Beach Gaming having worked on it for so many years?
It was disappointing, for sure. It was disappointing that it ended, Ichigo and Bleach, it was just one of, I mean, it's definitely one of my favorite series to work on, one of my favorite characters to work on. So it was a little bittersweet, you know, for sure. Like, I was happy to kind of, like, look at other things and start working on a bunch of other projects, but at the same time, it was like, oh man, I really liked that one. It was one that was just fun for me to play. There's a lot more freedom in that character for me, because they really kind of trusted us with our characters at that point. So it was a bit of a bummer. But with that new live action, you know, there's it potential. I mean, it's actually really good. If you haven't seen it, it's pretty decent for anime, you know, adapted into live action. Usually they're terrible. This one's surprisingly not that bad. The action director, Yuji Shimomura, who does Devil May Cry with 3, 4, and 5, actually did all the action in the Bleach movie. So it's pretty good, but I know that they released it on Netflix already without English, without an English dub. Not saying that there weren't people on Netflix. Not saying that I worked on one that's going to be out in a few weeks, but you should check it out. Yes?
When working on Bleach, what was the hardest day on the set?
When working on Bleach, what was the hardest day? There weren't really too many hard days. You know? I think the only time that it was maybe hard would be if I was Ichigo fighting and screaming, then Hollow Ichigo fighting and screaming, and then full Hollow Ichigo, you know, screaming. And so doing all of that in, like, you know, 4 hours or whatever, it starts to wear out your voice. Those would be the only times, but I usually had a lot of fun in that. Again, like I said, there's a lot of freedom in there. So I had some freedom to, like, add things if I wanted to, or adjust things here and there. Fight stuff is always fun for me.
Lean on the door.
I'll tell you this brief story. It was when Ichigo, was it the Visors? I guess he goes in there, and then like, oh, so you finally decided to join us. And he says, no way, right? It's like two flaps. And the Japanese was like, no way. And that's what was in the script. And I was like, that just feels weird. Like, I don't feel like I can be like, no way. It just was weird, you know? And so instead, I just said, bite me. Wendy Lee was directing at the time, and she was like, yeah, okay. Left it in there, but it's kind of fun. It's fun, you know. At that point, it's like I was so much the character that it was like, they let me do my thing. Yes.
Who was the most emotional
Yukio, most emotional. It's hard for me to think back into the first series because it feels like it was so long ago, or the movie. I remember feeling certain moments that I enjoyed, but there was definitely some stuff in the second series or second season of it. But I can't remember specific moments. I just remember, I really get into the character. I don't recall a specific moment though, I really don't. I just remember, there's just so much, for that character, I'll just say this, there are certain characters where I feel like as soon as I go in there, I'm plugged in, I am that character at that moment. Some characters kind of have to work into it because it's like, well, this is weird or something bizarre. But that's one of the ones where I feel like I could be that character instantly within whatever's happening. Ichigo is another one. Lelouch, actually, in the beginning took me a little bit of time, but then eventually, I was able to lock into that character as well. And there are certain moments where, you know, at the end of the first season, the end of the second season that I was in, I was just like, hang on a second, I need to get over this feeling right now before I can move on to something else. I can't really think of a specific moment. Yes. If they want me. Yeah, Jason's pretty locked in though, you know, he was the leader, you know, of the Power Rangers. I call myself a background ranger, you know. It's true. You go back and watch the series, you know, and it's mostly Tommy and Kimberly, maybe Billy, and then, you know, I'm standing in the back like this. Right. So, I didn't do a whole lot. I mean, there were moments that I had, but you know, not quite that many. But if they wanted me to come back, I'd probably come back. I would like it to be something cool. I don't want to show up and just be like unconscious. Adam, it's unconscious. We gotta help him. Yes. Trigun, favorite experience from Trigun? It's the first anime that I worked on, so that alone just made it like one of my favorite experiences. It's like I'd never done any real dubbing other than, you know, Power Rangers, but it was Helmet, so it's easier. Occasionally we had to match our own flaps, but that's not that hard. And Helmet stuff is this, you know.
Right, okay. Let's go.
Helmet, so it's really easy. There's no lip flap. So Trigun was tricky, you know, but it's just such a different character from, you know, who I played in Power Rangers, you know, where I didn't really do a whole lot, and then, you know, like this wild, goofy character. The whole love and peace thing is funny. Anything with donuts, there's like a lot of little moments, you know, or him having the headphones on, dancing his way into the thing, whatever. There's a lot of fun moments in that, for sure. Let's see, who else? Between me and Jason David Frank, he's got probably 100 pounds on me. that'd be not a wise choice on my part. Yes? Characters that are voiced? No, I can't think of any. I don't recall any at the moment, actually. I tried to post a few things. I was talking about the whole background ranger thing, but I posted one not too long ago. But it was, I should repost it when Valentine's Day comes around, but it's like Tommy and Kimberly, and Tommy's got these like flowers, and he's like flirting with her and hitting him. And then I am literally in the background like this. Like, I don't know if I was just done with the scene or didn't know I was on camera, but they're just like, oh, he's a greedy dude. I posted it my Instagram if you want to go check it out. It's a few weeks back, but it's good times. I even zoom in to my face. It's sad. Yes, you have a question? All right. How do I do my stunts? So I studied martial arts for a very long time. If I told you how long, you would not believe me. But I have been studying martial arts for a very long time. I'm still studying martial arts, various different styles. My first style was Shaolin Kung Fu. And so doing the stunts, it just depended on what it was. Back in the day, the Power Rangers, when we joined Power Rangers, you had to either be a martial artist or a gymnast or a dancer. And so a couple of us were martial artists, some of them were gymnasts, and there were a couple of dancers too. And so being able to move and things like that was helpful. So mostly because of martial arts, that's how I was able to do it. All right, yes?
What was it like working with all the former Rangers on that live action?
The Order?
Yes.
The Order was, okay, so you can check it out. I think it's on YouTube. You can find the trailers still on YouTube, I believe. The Order movie. There's another movie called The Order, so you might have to look around a little bit digging, but it's like five trailers. But anyways, it was like 20 different Power Rangers. It was basically Power Rangers Civil War, you know? But we weren't like superheroes. Instead, we were like assassins, you know? Yeah, so we shot like, basically I helped co-produce with Karen Ashley. I helped co-produce the teasers, the trailers that we shot. But that's all the involvement I had. In fact, the part that I played in it was actually Jason Frank's, was originally intended to be Jason Frank's role, but he wasn't able to do it, and so I stepped in and just kind of filled out that spot. But yeah, I think, but they've continued on now. They've got like graphic novels for, I guess, telling the story before, the backstory before doing the movie. But it was fun. It was a lot of fun to work with everyone and kind of see everyone do their thing. For some people, it had been a long time, so it was kind of cool to do it. Yes, very back.
So, have you seen the end of the Bleach manga? And if so, what did you think of the end of Ichigo and Orihime having a son?
I don't mind that they have a son. I kind of feel like it's a lot like Naruto's. I don't know, like, I didn't really read any of the ending of Naruto, I just, like, heard about it, and then obviously I know about it, because I see, like, a Boruto show going on, I'm like, what is that? Naruto's son, huh? I don't know, I think it's alright. I think it could have been cooler. Show up when we were about to have rehearsal.
It's Wolverine.
He'd say, hey, come check out this anime. He'd show me, and it's
Jackman.
Like Wolf's Ring. And he's like, man, you gotta try to get this part. And I was like, oh, I just got cast in there. But, that's how it worked, like all the time. And Bleach was another one. He's like, he was watching this show called Bleach. So I would see it every once in a while, like before rehearsal, and he's watching it or whatever, and he's talking about it. He's like, man, it's so cool. And he's, you gotta get it. And I was like, I just auditioned for that, and then ended up booking it or whatever. It was cool. So I was kind of familiar with the character, and I knew it was a popular series. I was pretty excited about it, but the audition process was, it was like this. I went in, I auditioned for the role. Actually, I auditioned for Ichigo, I auditioned for Uryu, and Kon. There's a couple other characters I auditioned for. It's like five or six different characters I auditioned for. And then with Ichigo, there was like certain call-outs, like there's Bankais and Getsuka Tensho that had to be called out. And I remember when I was auditioning for Ichigo that I was like, man, I gotta do my best for this guy right here, you know? And I remember being told to make him nicer during the audition. And I was like, that's weird, because that's not what he feels like to me, you know? And because he felt more kind of raw, a little bit like a streetwise kid, you know, and they wanted to make him nicer, you know. They said, play him a little nicer, you know, because we're not really sure if the American audience will accept him if he's kind of, you know, a punk or whatever. And I was like, it doesn't feel right to me, because one of the scenes I was doing it, he's kicking these dudes around. And I'm like, how am I supposed to sound nice doing that? So it was really weird. And so I played it nice, you know, and I was like, this is off to me. But then there was the Bankai's Getsuka Tensho and call-outs that I had to do. And so for those, he was just like, whatever, just do whatever you do. And so I made those sound the way I wanted them to sound. And I got called back for a second audition on that character only because of the Bankai's and stuff, the call-outs. And then I was told, all right, don't make him as nice. Kind of make him a little more gruff, kind of like what you were thinking of doing. And then we'll kind of go from there or find it somewhere in between. And so I did that and ended up booking the role. But yeah, it was super fun. And we've gone through different directors throughout, you know, the process. But one of the things is, like, I had sat down and I watched 60 episodes, you know, that first arc, right? I was like, I was watching it. And I was like, oh, what's going to happen? And I stayed up all night watching the whole thing to find out if he was going to save Rukia. I was like, what's going on? You know, it took me forever. Like, I did nothing else but that. And then I got to the end of that, so I knew the series from that 60 episodes. I knew my character, exactly what was happening. And so I would go in to work on it, and I knew the story a lot better than the director. And so it was like, they're telling me, this is what's happening, and I'm like, that's not really what's happening. This is what's happening. And then, oh, okay, that makes sense. And then I was like, and there were certain things that were said in the Japanese, but the translation was, it was mistranslated into English, and I was like, that's actually not what it's saying. This is what it should be saying. Oh, okay. So there's a lot of that kind of going on in the beginning, because, you know, it was still earlier in the whole dubbing stuff, but, you know, we corrected a lot of things. I mean, I'm not saying, like, I saved it. I'm just saying that they did give a lot of freedom in the beginning, even in the beginning there, too, to be able to do that, which I'm surprised. Yes? Who's my favorite role to play as? Yeah. Favorite look? Oh, quote.
No. Who's your favorite character to play as? And if so, what is your favorite quote from that character?
I have a lot. Like, I don't have, like, one favorite, though. That's the problem. I've got, like, a handful of them, and I don't want to, like, shout out all of their things right now. Well, I was talking about Ichigo. He's one of my favorites. So, how about a Bankai? Will that work for you? Don't need the mic on this one. Hope I don't spit my gum out. Yes. I did see it. Most of it was cool. I liked most of it. There were certain things, like when I watched it, I kept thinking back to our series and what we were, what we did. And my kids can watch my show. And this one, I was like, I don't want them to watch it just yet, you know, because they're saying some things that I felt like they really leaned into the kids with attitude kind of thing, you know. It was, you know, there's not a lot of cursing, but there was some cursing in it, you know. I'm like, I don't want my kids saying these things to me yet. other things were like the suits. I couldn't get used to them because I couldn't really tell the difference really from the helmets. It wasn't very clear if this was a Mastodon or this was, you know, whatever. So it's, you know, I liked our suits from the movie better. Even the Zords to me were, you know, weird. Six-legged Mastodon? I don't even understand that. Like, what? No, it's so alien, and it's not a Mastodon. So there were things like that. Goldar, I was like, what? No. The putties, I liked our putties, even though they were cheesy. Our show was cheesy. Theirs was much more of a modern take on it, more of a, you know, going that, that Marvel route of things. And I thought they did a good job of that. But it was just, it was different. It wasn't the same as ours, but, and I'm not saying ours was better, because ours was definitely a lot cheesier. you know, there's some things that were missing for me. There were definitely, I was expecting a lot more martial arts, a lot more action. It took a long time for them to get into that stuff. Yes? So far, I've only seen from here to the hotel. So it looks a lot like other places I've been to. But it's been cloudy as well, so I haven't been. I can tell there's mountains somewhere beyond those clouds. No, I know it's beautiful here. I mean, just from the Discovery Channel. But that's going to, unfortunately, probably be my experience. I'm going to try to get out tomorrow and is there? I don't have a car with me, so it'll be a lot more than 2 hours for me. Yeah, I would like to, actually. I'm hoping to get out a little bit tomorrow night to kind of check it out. But because I hear there's a nightlife here. And so I'm going to see what that's all about. Yes. What was I, the voice of in Saints Row? I don't remember. I think I was a gangster. I think I was like a Hispanic gangster. I honestly think that's what it was. It was a while ago, but I think I was like a gang member. Yes. Well, if I know what the series is, like if they tell me what it is, then I will look it up for myself and I'll try to do some research on my own. And especially if it's like an anime, because then I might be able to find an episode or something and find my character and kind of see what was done before, get some kind of information that way, right? Do definitely look things up. Sometimes it's like an original project and then you only find like the like an image of the character, like maybe I'm not sent a picture of the character, but if I can find one online, then it gives me a little more information. So I try to do a lot of research before going into it, and then as soon as I get there, I ask a ton of questions. The director, the producer, the writer, whoever's in there, I just ask questions because I want to know what they're expecting from me as well. That way, you know, where am I coming from? You know, what is the scene that's happening? Do I know these characters? What is my relationship to these characters? Do I like this person in front of me? You know, and even though I'm saying that I like this person, am I really thinking something else? You know, I've got to think of all those things in a short amount of time. You know? So I ask as many questions as I can to kind of give me that information. And then if it's an anime, a lot of times we get to watch it beforehand. Sometimes we don't, but a lot of times we do get to watch it beforehand. And then you don't get the script ahead of time in most cases, because they don't want that information to get out, you know, and so they don't want you to, like, you know. Oh yeah, we don't have subtitles. We have a script when we show up, and, you know, on the day. So you have to be really good at cold reading. You know, like you get it right there and you go, Dasani, you know, whatever. Whatever's happening in the scene. So it's like, you just have to know it, and then if it's anime, then you've got to match your flaps as well, so you've got to watch it and time out how you say it so it fits. You know, and that way you know if you need to add a pause, you need to add another word, you need to speed it up, whatever. It takes a lot, it's a lot of work, but it's fun, you know. And again, some characters are just, you can just dial in for whatever reason, you know. I've got enough baggage that I can, you know, find a place to relate to something, you know. And so for me, it really is just trying to find a way for me to be that character, for me to believe that I'm that character and make it believable, you know. And I've heard many times, but like for me, if, like I've seen a lot of fan dubs and stuff, and I'll just tell a quick story. Eureka 7, this was back when I was working on Eureka 7, and we had already, a ton of it was out, and I was at a con, and somebody's like, oh, my friend is doing this fan dub of Eureka 7, it's playing Renton, it sounds just like you. And I was like, oh, okay, I should check it out, and somebody sounds just like me, they're going to potentially get my job. And I go and I start watching it, and it sounds like he's in his bedroom closet, and he doesn't want to wake his mom in the next room. And so everything is played kind of down a notch, you know, even the screams are like, ah, you know, because he doesn't want to scream so loud, you know, and those things for me are super important, you know. I know some people, there are techniques and stuff like that, but like for me, if you watched any of Bleach, I'm screaming, you know, or Devil May Cry, I'm screaming, I'm like letting it all out there, you know, because I think you're going to notice. When you're listening, you're going to know if I'm holding back, you know, or not. And here's another thing. In Gundam, Iron-Blooded Orphans, I was playing Orga. So when I started doing research on Orga, and I heard the original Japanese, I'm like, oh, that's not a character I would typically be cast as, because the tones, our tones are very different, you know? And I was like, what am I going to do? And so what I did from home to the job was I would scream out every street sign. I just screamed at the top of my lungs. And so when I was in to work, I was kind of down a register, not a full register, but I was lower and raspy and just kind of, I sounded like I had been in battle. And I'm a little exhausted because I wanted, and you probably, half the time you probably can't even tell. But for me, it's that having that feeling, and somebody will pick up on it and be like, okay, yeah, this guy's been some places, you know? So anyway. That's a dumb thing to do, though. I'm just going to tell you. You know, there are probably wiser techniques, but for me, I wanted to feel that as well. Yes? Most difficult thing about recording Trigun? I think for me, it was my first time to dub. I don't remember too many very difficult things. I think, it was different enough, and I was excited enough to be playing something like that, that it was just, everything was just fun. I think the hardest thing was saying his name. And there's a moment where he introduces himself to Wolfwood. And, is it Wolfwood? Yeah, it's to Wolfwood. And it's like, it was like a paragraph for his name, and I'm like, oh my goodness, you know? And I was like, what is this? And then I have to match flaps at the same time? You know, so it took a few takes for me to get that down. I guess that would be the hardest part for me. Yes? I wasn't familiar with it at all. I received an audition that did not have the name, I don't think. I think it had other names, or it might have just said, I can't remember actually. But it got to me, it was an audition, and it had a picture of Jonathan Joestar. And when I saw the picture, I was like, wait, is this Fist of the North Star? I was like, dude, this is awesome, all right. And so I was like excited to play, but then it was like, it said slight British accent. I was like, slight British accent, what? All right, you know? So I auditioned for it. I didn't know anything about it. And then once I got it, then I was given more information about it, and I started looking it up. But it's a very bizarre adventure, for sure. There is a moment where I'm fighting ahead. And there's another moment, actually, I'm fighting Dio, and I throw this rose at him, right, in the fight, and then he goes, like, fuck a minute. And I'm like, I look at the director, I was like, was there poison on the rose? No. I was like, oh, okay. Just the rose. It's like, yeah. Huh. All right. Okay, so there's things like that. But man, that show is wild. That's fun. Well, I know that for sure. It was pretty bizarre. It was fun. Yes? As JoJo? I can't think of anything. How about this? I did this often.
Dio!
Yes. Zelda was definitely awesome. Was that Nintendo 64? Is that what it was on originally? It was NES, that's right, it was NES. That was back when I played games, you know. But it was great. I always remember thinking, like, man, I want to voice this character. But never got to do that. What does it make me think of? Oh, it made me think of, like, the last time I really was, like, playing a game. The last game that I actually spent a lot of time on was, I can't think of it. Kingdom Hearts. It's Kingdom Hearts. Yeah, the first one. I spent so much time on it. And I hadn't played video games like a whole lot. I played here and there, And then this one, I got it, you know, I think it was maybe for Christmas or something. And now I was just playing it forever. And I was at this moment where I was like fighting the boss. So I was really close to the end, I could tell. But then I didn't realize that you had to like increase your life bar or whatever. And I was like, why am I constantly losing? And then I was like, oh, I have to go back to this thing and then do that and increase it. And I got so frustrated. I spent so much time on it. But anyways, I'm playing this for like weeks and weeks, and then I'm like sitting in the house, like not doing anything like that. I would just go there and do that, and then there's one moment where I look down and I got my Cheetos spread across my chest. And I'm like, what am I doing? I need to go outside. So I go outside, there's sun. And so I had to like stop. I guess it was ruining my life. Yes? How did it feel to replace him?
Yeah.
Felt great. It's so funny, I get asked that so often, but it wasn't something that I thought about, you know? I knew that, I just thought we were coming in to be Rangers. I didn't know we were replacing anybody or anything. It just said when I was studying Kung Fu and my instructor saw on the paper that they're looking for new Rangers, and he came up to me and was like, hey, you should go give it a shot. And I went to an audition. Audition, and then when they flew us out to California to do the callback auditions, there was that's when I noticed, oh, we're black, red, and yellow. But I didn't know again that we're replacing anyone. I didn't know anything about the story. So it wasn't until I was on the show that I was like, I'm wearing somebody else's clothes right now because it's got his name all over. And these kids are thinking that I'm Zach. After the, you know, after we rap, and there's like a bunch of kids outside. They're like, "Hey, Zach!" I'm like, "No, I play Adam." But okay. So it wasn't something I thought about. You know, it was obviously, you know, just what it was. 1 minute left. One more question. Okay. So I've got one question left. Should I just tell you guys a story? All right, I'll try to make it quick, is that all right? Yeah. All right, it's gonna take an hour to tell the story. All right, so I could probably tell the story tomorrow, but I might as well tell you right now. All right, so this is the quarter story, and if you haven't heard my quarter story, it's an old story. This was from a while ago, back in the days when I was working on Bleach. But whenever I go to work, I have to take the freeway to go to work. I live in California, I have to take the freeway to get back home, and there's an off-ramp that I have to take, and there's like a signal light there. And I'd have to make a left to go under this overpass in the freeway. And always on that corner where that light is, there's always like some homeless guy standing on the corner. Not the same homeless guy, but just various homeless guys standing on the corner whatever given day. And when I was in my car, I've never really given money while in my car because it felt weird, like I'm strapped down, I don't know, what if they try to rob me or whatever, so I never did. This one day I exit the freeway and there's like four or five cars in front of me. So from here to a little bit beyond this room, the back of the room, four or five cars in front of me, it's a red light, and behind me pulls up this monster truck. And this person, I can't see who's in it because it's got a tinted window, but I can feel the vibration of the engine because they're revving it. They're, you know, and it's like shaking my car, and I start to freak out. And in my head, I see Monster Madness, and the light turns green, bing, and he runs us all over. So I got that image playing on in my head, and I'm thinking, dude, we better go because this person is anxious, you know? And I have this Ziploc bag full of carrots that I had left over from lunch. I'm scarfing down like my last supper. And I look over, you know, and there wasn't a homeless guy there, there's a homeless woman. You know, it's the first time I'd seen a homeless woman, and my heart just went out to her. You know, I started thinking, what if that's my mom, you know? I mean, I felt bad, like I felt like I should do something. And so I was like, all right, you know what? In LA, I don't know about here, but in LA you have to pay for parking everywhere. And so my cup holders were full of quarters. And I thought, I just finished all these carrots, I got an empty Ziploc bag, what if I take all these quarters? Ziploc bag and give it to her. And I'd never done this before. And again, I was like a good distance away from her. And so I was like, you know what, I'm gonna do it. And I scoop up all these quarters, I put it in the Ziploc bag, and I'm like, dude, this is like 3 pounds worth of quarters. I'm gonna go change her life. And I roll down my window and I hold my hand out like this. And I look over to her, and again, four or five cars away from me, she sees me and she has a sign and she goes, and I'm in my car, four or five cars away, going like, wait, am I supposed to get out? I'm thinking like, I thought you were gonna come over here. You're not coming over here? And I'm like trying to like sign to her like, I don't know how to do this. I can't go that far. I don't know what to do. And the light turns green. And these cars in front of me, they just take off, you know, like fast. Like they must have felt behind me. And so I instinctively start going. And so now I look down and I'm like, wait, now I'm going 20 miles an hour with a 3 pound bag of quarters and a monster truck on my tail. I can't stop now. And I'm like, I don't know how this exchange is going to happen. I can't just throw it in her gut like a football player. Oh, darn it! You know? What if she hangs onto it too long and I pull her out of my car and I kill her? What if I hang onto it too long and I fly out and I die? So I'm like starting to freak out. Then I get this moment of clarity, this epiphany. I'm like, Johnny, you're a martial artist. Just focus. You're also Asian. Do the math. It's 20 miles an hour, a 3 pound bag of quarters. All you have to do is go, and watch it gracefully land in her hand. So there I am, 20 miles an hour, 3 pound bag of quarters, feeling pretty confident. And I go, now. And I release. And if you've ever been in an accident, time slows down. It really does. I say this all the time, but I think like God was upstairs like, whoo! Jesus, Moses, bring some nachos and popcorn. Oh yeah, we're recording it. We'll play it back when he's dead. Slow mo. Many times. So there I am. I release this 3 pound bag of quarters. And time slows down as I watch this 3 pound bag of quarters fly 20 miles an hour. 3 pounds worth of quarters, 20 miles an hour, smacks her in the face. The bag rips open, quarters fall, glistening in the sunlight, and all I can do is this. No! She goes down, quarters go flying everywhere, and I'm going so fast that I actually screech around the corner, like, arr! There's nowhere for me to turn around, I just continue under the overpass, going home. Feeling dirty. So, there's a lesson to be learned. Don't give homeless people money while driving your car. It's a true story. So, here's another part of this story that I always tell because it boggles my mind. Before that day, there's always some homeless guy standing on the corner. That was the first time that there's a homeless woman. After that day, no homeless people on the corner. It confuses me. I think, well, what happened? Did they tell the story about someone, did she die? And I think like there's a bridge somewhere, right? And there's like this homeless guy by a fire, and there's another guy walks up to him, hey, Bob. Hey, Jed. Hey, where's Sally? You didn't hear? She's dead. The quarter man got her. Thank you guys so much. I'll see you guys tomorrow.